Hey, what's going on, everyone? Christian Duke from StrengthEdX.com here with Mighty Mike Quinn at his home in Lake Worth, Florida. Mike, how's it going today?
Yeah, everything's great. Actually, we're at my parents' house.
At your parents' house. I got to talk to your mom and dad while we was waiting for you. Yeah. Your dad's ripped. I mean, like, he was telling me he's been working out, doing personal training forever.
Yeah, well, he trained me when I was a kid.
Okay.
And I won all my shows. My first five competitions, you know, by the time I went all the way up to the Mr. Universe, and my dad trained me. But, you know, training. Not weightlifting,
right.
Training. Okay, there's a huge difference, and I don't see it anymore. Really, you know, don't see many hardcore guys anymore. But training is when you're barely catching your breath while your training partner goes, and then you go.
Okay.
And using heavy poundages to failure. You know, so I like Johnny Jackson and you know Branch Warren. There's only two hardcore videos I've seen that I think are true.
Okay.
Gritty, you know?
Yeah, for sure. Take us back to Brockton, Massachusetts, where you grew up. I know you said a lot of champions have come out from there.
Wow.
What was like?
The city, I was so lucky. Brockton's called home of the champions, and there was a court battle going on for about 20 years because Doug Flutie's hometown thought they were home of the champions. Well, it wasn't happening. And finally, in 1997, it was on the front page of the Brockton Enterprise that... You know, Brockton's wins the law case stating, you know, it's home of the champions and we're in legislature, but it says Brockton's home of champions because of Rocky Marciano, Marvin Hagler, and Mike Quinn, Mr. Universe. I mean, that was biggest accolade. You can't even imagine. Imagine being in the same sentence with those
right.
two guys.
Absolutely.
Those are legends. So it started from there. We have a lot of champions from Brockton, Massachusetts.
And Massachusetts in general, too, like Matarazzo.
Are you
and-
kidding me? Cutler, Matarazzo, DeMeo, me, I may forget somebody. Victor Terra, who's from the IAU, was amazing.
Jose Raymond, too, from the 212s.
Jose Ramos. And now who else?
Just a bunch of people, yeah.
Yeah, I've lost count. But I would have to say, on a whole, I think Massachusetts has the most pro bodybuilders to come out of this.
And
state.
It's a small state, too. I mean,
yeah,
it's not...
Yeah,
not
the smallest, but I honestly think that's the most pros at any state in the nation.
So, talk to us about when you first got started, because, you know, a lot of people, they see bodybuilding, all they can think of is drugs, but you were lifting, you were benching, what, like 400 pounds when you were natural? I mean...
Fuck yeah.
Take us back to that, like...
Well, it was very simple. I mean, my father trained me, and my dad threatened every drug dealer in the gym. You know, you ever go near my kid with this shit, meaning steroids,
right.
I'm gonna bust your hole. So everybody stayed away from me. I mean, the first day I ever bench press, I was 14 years old, I did 200 pounds.
Wow.
By the time I was a senior in high school, I was benching 440 with a powerlifting style though, you know, everything slow. And I just, you know, I was amazingly strong. I mean, I just, you know, I squatted 600 and deadlifted 600 in a power meet when I was a teenager in the 198s. The only stronger teenager than me in the history is Eddie Robinson. Eddie Robinson still has the record for 601 bench press as a teenager.
Jeez.
So, you know, yeah, you could say I'm a power bodybuilder.
Awesome.
I'm very much wanted to play professional football. And... You know, I got a scholarship. I went to play in Canada. And, you know, I got up there and they kind of lied to me. They told me I had a full weight room and everything.
Yeah, I remember you talking about that on an interview, I think.
Yeah, man, they didn't have a full weight room. All they had was 300 pounds of weight. So, you know, of course, the football players were 2 weeks before the schools that were open. And the first day, we had strength trials. Excuse me, and all they had was 320 pounds, I explained it before. And they stopped me when I was at like 20 or 25 reps. They told me to stop.
Yeah.
The strongest guy on the team did 8, struggling. I was just like, bing, 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 bing.
Right.
Like, I was almost looking around while I'm doing it.
Yeah.
You don't forget, 315 is like warm-up weight for me.
Wow.
And the fact I was so pissed off, because the day before, you know, you got to take all these seniors' lockers to their dorms. Now, the dorms are like a half a mile away. you got to drag it to the dome. So I already was having a real lot of resentment, was building huge, you know. And I didn't talk, I didn't say a word. I let them keep, you know, fucking with me. And so the day we got football pads, we had to do two-on-one drills. I had to go against, you know, the starting tackle and guard, and the starting halfback had to make it through. Okay, and there's only two cones, you have X amount, and they really got respect for me at that point. The very first carry, I was already in the back row field tackling the guy. And they were crazy. Like, they didn't know. But I had so, at 5'8", I had so much push-off ability. When a guy is over 6 feet tall, it's so much easier for me to dump him on his ass. Because I get my hands underneath his pads and pick him right up and throw him into the back reel.
For sure.
Yeah.
So talk to us about, like, when you discover bodybuilding. I know that, you actually had to go professional twice.
Yeah,
which a lot of people... Can you explain to us? I know it was something...
Explain it. That would only happen to somebody like me. It was never going to...
I think this...
Thanks, Ma.
Taste it.
Spray bottles, look.
Yeah. Well, just see if this... Is it
no,
water?
No, I don't... Yeah, it's water. Okay.
Okay,
stop.
You got one, too.
It's my mom.
Your mom was awesome.
It was everything. Yeah, kidding me? It wasn't for my family, I never would have been a pro. I never would have been a professional athlete.
So what was going on with the AAU and the NPC
You know what? That sucked, honestly. You know, I went Teenage Mr. America. You know, I'm 19, and I'm already placing 10th in the Mr. America at that time. So I'm already ranked as a teenager. So the next year, I got to go to the Junior America, and I get beat by Lee Haney. You know, he was first, I was second. I almost beat him. You know, he had four first places, and I had three first places.
Okay.
And, you know, of course he beat me, and that's fine. That year I went to the 86 Nationals. No, I'm sorry, that year I went to the 82 Nationals, is when Lee won. Okay, and... you know, I didn't do well. I mean, I was working with somebody that screwed up my peak on purpose. It's when this guy, Matt Mendenhall, came on the scene, who was an amazing, amazing bodybuilder, who could have broke all the records and done anything. But again, like most of these bodybuilders that have absolute superior bodies to the rest of us, actually don't have the balls to get on stage. You know, they want to be guaranteed an automatic win. You know, and, but he was a phenom. I mean, you know, he had movie star good looks and V taper. I mean, the kid had a beautiful physique. I mean, kind of like Bob Paris, but bigger.
You know? And I actually read about Matt Mendenhall in Bob Paris's book, Gorilla Suit. He was, writing about that. The guy was just a total freak, like you said.
Phenom.
A phenom. Not even a freak, a phenom.
A phenom. You call somebody like me a freak.
Absolutely.
You know, because of the strength and the way I train. But this guy didn't even train hard. Didn't have to.
Yeah.
I mean... I don't know. I couldn't be a professional athlete and not train hard.
Okay.
You know? I said, the two to me don't go together. Okay. In 82, I competed against Lee Haney in the Junior Nationals, and he beat me. So, I was still kind of a favorite going into the Nationals that year, but a guy had been working with a phenom named Matt Mendenhall, and he made sure I missed my peak, and I had a place in sixth. So, you gotta understand, AAU, I mean, Massachusetts is really AAU country. And, you know, I stayed with the NPC in 83, you know, went to Miss USA, took fourth, but, you know, any show I went to up in Massachusetts, I mean, you know, the head powers to be for the AAU kept saying, listen, come over to us. I mean, we'll treat you so much better. So they give me I'm allowed to go in this 84 Mr. America, and, go on the show, look awesome, they give me third place. I mean, fucking third. And I should have won the show because 3 weeks later, I went over to England and beat the Mr. America and the Naba Mr. Universe, which I beat Joe Miko, who, you know, recently died, which is horrifying. You know, if you look through AAU, all right, every person that's ever won the Mr. America automatically has won the universe. Okay, you'll see in history, I'm the only guy ever to beat the Mr. America. It was like he wasn't even there. I mean, but,
wow.
You know, England's so hardcore, and I was such a hardcore guy that, you know, I fit right in. And plus, I wasn't like anybody else, you know? I mean, nobody was like me. No, you know, everybody was so afraid, you know, upsetting the powers to be that I didn't give a shit. I'm the one taking drugs. I'm the one risking my health. You know, you're not going to tell me how to talk, how to behave. But you know what? They couldn't stop me. I mean, my, right, let's not get caught up. So I come back in 84 and I contact Wayne D'Amelio, who's a piece of shit. Okay. I said, listen, I want the Navi universe. I want to, you know, I'd like to turn pro. Oh no. I had to start from scratch. Jeez. Now, the Mr. Universe I won, every celebrity and legend won the same show I did. Arnold, Lou, Bill Pearl, every single guy that's ever competed in the history of life. Serge Nabre, I mean, I'm running out. Reg Park, Larry Scott. I mean, these guys all won Mr. Universe. It was only Mr. Universe. The AAU owned the name of the Mr. Universe. And, you know, why do you think they did the NPC Nationals? Because the AAU owned the name for Mr. America.
Oh, okay.
You know, so they owned
it. Yeah, I've heard that. Yeah, I have heard that.
You know, there was nothing... There was nothing for them really to do at that point. You know, now I'm building my, now I'm building my reputation now. You know, these are the years I'm building my reputation and, you know, I'm training hard and I'm just, I'm either going to turn pro or die.
Right.
In the gym. It was no other way for me. I mean, and I remember, you know, the year that I trained for the USA in 87, I told my dad, I said, if I don't go pro at this show, I'm going to go home, we're going to break my body down, start doing sprints, and be a free agent and walk onto a football field. Now, that would have been great for me, and I know I would have made a team because I was so strong and so fast, and I was good to tackle it, you know. But that didn't happen through the grace of God. But coming back, they were horrible to me. Wayne D'Amelio was, not anybody else. You know, the magazines, people, the photographers, I get along with all of them because I work my ass off when, you know. And everybody wonders, you know why I got so much publicity? I don't tell you why. Because I didn't turn down any work. I set up photo sessions. I set up 3 sessions before the Olympia. And as soon as I'd done, I'd set up 3 more. So I'd have every magazine covered.
Yeah, and not only didn't you turn up work, it seems like you went on all those Grand Prix shows too. I mean,
oh, yeah.
Guys nowadays peak once or twice a year. You were doing it like... Oh, 5-6 times a month.
No, we were holding it. But
they're holding it, yeah, exactly. That's a better,
you know,
yeah.
Honestly, the truth behind what's happening to people's bodies now is insulin. Insulin is ruining their physiques.
Right.
They're losing the ability to get shredded because they're growing so fast that the muscle separation is filling in.
Yeah.
Instead of being extremely deep cuts like we were in my era, it's not like that anymore. And I blame it on the drugs. I mean, mm-hmm. It's all drugs now.
Speaking about one of those Grand Prix, a week or two ago, Ron Love called you. I dialed the number there and talked to you.
Was that
Yeah, talk to us a little bit about that Phil Hill incident and the Samir incident, any incident you want to talk about.
It was kind of, I don't know, maybe I was more aggressive than I usually was. I don't know. It's a lot of stress to hold your peak for, you know, 6 weeks after Olympia.
Right.
You know, and that gets on your nerves. And you know, me and Samir we're best of friends now, but back then, he was an asshole, and honestly, I was an asshole too. You know, you're on drugs, you're dehydrated, and nothing comes out of that but bad shit.
Yeah.
I can tell you that right now, especially for me. And we were at the England Grand Prix, and, you know, we're in the lineup. It was a big show.
Yeah.
And me and Barry DeMay are on the end. I'm on the end, there's Barry and there's Samir. So what Samir started doing, he kept pulling his body out, totally blocking me and Barry.
Right.
So I said, you know, Samir, you got to move in, please. And I'm being nice. And I said, Samir, you know, move in. You're blocking me and Barry. So he didn't do it. So here there are 3 guys on the podium, and I lean across Barry and slap Samir in the chest. The noise was outrageous. The whole crowd is now looking at me and Samir having this whole altercation. And... you know, it's not something I'm proud of, but...
Well, he denies it. He says it never happened, but I don't know how you could deny something like that if everybody...
Come on.
If you had done it backstage, you did it in front of everybody,
listen, so... I never lied about anything.
Yeah.
I mean, Ron will tell you that. I was ready to blow all the time.
But he said that I think when Phil Hill punched him in the head, he didn't even have a chance to react because you were all over the guy.
His shoes.
Yeah.
Looking down, all Ron did was turn his head and look up while he's tying it, and... wham. All I see is that punch go straight on hit wrong. And I was like, I'm just in sweatpants now. I'm barefoot. And now right in front of me is a camera crew.
Okay.
Full-blown camera crew trying to get all this. So what do? I come, I kill them. I run them over like a tractor running over an ant. I mean, it broke the camera. The lights went everywhere.
Right.
And I get into the room because he was in the room across from me, like right across the hallway. And I see it, and I just snap because I like Ron. Ron was a, you know, he was lucky I did that because Ron would have fucking killed him.
All right, so I got to ask you this.
A black belt.
And yeah, he was a cop in Detroit, too. I mean, he's the real deal there.
He was the nicest guy, but those guys you don't really fuck with. Detroit cop?
Yeah.
Come on.
So since I've got you on here, and you won't lie, I gotta ask you another question. 1992, was Gary Stridham natural?
Fuck no. You know what? And I don't, you know what? I don't care, okay? I don't give a shit what Gary Stridham. Gary Stridham is a legend in his own mind. Okay, you can look back at my career. I competed against the best bodybuilders in the world. Now, Gary Stridham, when the Mr. Olympia got fifth, it was a gift. And did we ever see him again? No. Okay, you know, now he lives in Thailand. Why would you live in Thailand?
You know. No. Oh, I don't know. I don't know.
Well, suppose he likes.
Well, anyways, so let's move on. So, another question I had for you. Talk to us about getting into the WBF, because Ron Lovett said that he was flown out and, you know, a full course dinner, and he was wined and dined, and he chose not to do it, but I know you did, and I know it was very lucrative for you.
Who do you think started the whole thing? Me. Vince went through me. He has a mansion in Boca, and I was training at a gym in Boca, and he asked me, Mike, what do you think about me doing my own federation? Well, I said, I think you need to pay us.
Right.
You know, do what Joe Weed is not doing. So, I got an awesome contract. You know, I got like $400,000 for 2 years.
That's amazing.
Yeah, that's unheard of back then, you know. And thought I was doing the right thing, but, you know, yeah, remember, McMahon was dealing with that drug thing from the controversy with Hulk Hogan. That was not too far before that, about the WWF and the steroids.
Yeah.
So, he wanted to really clean up bodybuilding, which people don't want to see it.
Talk to us about going back to the IFBB after the WBF, because I recently spoke to Jim Quinn, and Jim said that was probably the hardest part of his career, because he didn't feel like he was being judged fairly, and some guys like Mike Christian never went back at all. So what was that like for you, like going back to the IFBB after the WBF folded?
Well, you know, I still, you know, my sister committed suicide in 89, so I was still all fucked up.
Yeah.
You know, once you're hot, you gotta have passion to do this. And passion, you know, all passion comes from your heart. You know, what you can generate and turn that into some kind of energy.
Sure.
And I was able to tap into all that bad energy I had, you know, where I was growing up, bullied, all, you know, all the shit you go through as a kid. And, you know, it affects you as an adult. So I was bullied as a kid, and by the time I got older, I said, no, I'm never going to get bullied again. I mean, it's never going to happen. And then I spent 2 years with Billy Blanks, who was the Tybo guy.
Who, so, yeah, made millions. Yeah, he's huge.
He taught me how to be a stone cold killer on the street.
Yeah.
He just showed me some basis shots that take people out, you know, and they can't breathe. So, you know, I paid the price of having to get into fights a lot. And, you know, now I don't go out, you know.
And so you probably used a lot of that passion in bodybuilding as well, right? Like when you went back to the IFBB, like, I don't think, you know, you didn't quit then. You haven't even formally, you've never really retired, actually. You've never, you know.
You know, there was always this thought of getting into the Masters, but now my body's deteriorating.
Right.
My hips are gone. You know, I mean, I've already had spinal fusion. I got titanium. You know, I got a 6-inch rod, 3-2-inch screws and pins in between the rods. And, my back started hurting again about 8 weeks ago, and I had another MRI on my spine, but it wasn't my spine. It's referring pain from my hips.
Okay.
And wow, did I make a huge mistake. About 8 weeks before this happened, I'm talking to somebody, I'm like, geez, Ronnie Coleman just had both his hips replaced. I wonder why this has never happened to me. Oh my God, what a big mistake that was.
Yeah.
Next thing you know, next week I have my first MRI on my right hip, but I need replacements, and I'm not going to do it right now.
Well, you look awesome. I mean, like, you were on Heavy Muscle TV 2-3 weeks ago, Dave Colombo said he's never seen look as good in a long time. And you just did an interview today with John Hansen as well. Yeah. So, I mean, at least you're you know, current, staying up.
To be honest with you, Christian, I don't get really small. And because, you know, I have that such a heavy base of, you know, hardcore training in my life, it'd be really impossible.
Yeah.
I'm eating two meals a day, and I can't get under 235 pounds.
I mean, I look at your dad. I mean, how, if you don't mind me asking, how old is your dad?
My dad's going to be 74.
Your dad is ripped. I mean, he's just shredded and symmetrical. I mean, it's not just shredded. Business. Yeah. So
my sister's a top trainer, too.
Your mom's in good shape. I mean, it looks like everybody in your family's in good shape.
Yeah,
so
great genetics.
You would probably have to go out of your way to get out of shape. You know, I don't think it could just... So...
You know, I'm not concerned with what I look like anymore.
Yeah.
You know, I've never been that much of an egomaniac, I guess. I didn't care what I looked like. All I cared when was the day I had to get on the stage.
Absolutely.
That's when you care the most. The rest to me was a gift. You know, taking pictures with, you know, fans and doing autographs.
Yeah.
I mean, that was always what it was about. You know, it was always about the
but
fans.
But unfortunately, even though, like, we're having a nice feel-good moment right now, I've got two questions to ask you that are not going to make you feel good at all. Two people, actually, that I'm sure that you equally despise. One is Chris Ludwigson, a.k.a. Chris Pacello.
Yeah.
Because we were just talking about how you never lost a fight, but this guy didn't actually fight you fair. He hit you with a bottle.
He hit me in the face with a tequila bottle.
And then the other guy I want to ask you about hasn't actually ever hit you or even met you, but seems to hate you, is Bostin Loyd. So let's talk about these two characters and kind of get them out of the way. What happened in, I think it was 96, with this Pacello guy?
You know, I was married at the time, and, you know, what people understand was Chris Ludwigson, you know, he called himself Chris Pacello. He wasn't Italian. He just thought he was a big shot. And he was the front guy for the Colombo Crime Family.
Okay.
And, you know, he did it. He knocked me out, screwed my face and teeth up bad. Knocked me out, and then he had to look into who I was. Now he's wants to have me really hurt. But at that time, I was already with somebody else. I mean, John Gotti was alive. You know, John Gotti had $250,000 running through my gym, so he couldn't have anything happen to me. You know, they weren't going to do anything to me.
Right.
Because, you know, once you're kind of associated with somebody, they take pride in being like, you know, don't fuck with our guy.
Right.
I mean, I believe in the street, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, Chris, and then for the next couple months after that, he hired bodyguards, and I've reached out to him so many times. I was like, well, let's get it on, let's sell tickets to it.
Yeah.
I know people would come to it, but you gotta understand, even at my age right now, when I go bipolar, I feel nothing.
Well, you know, the same way that I guess he couldn't hurt you because you were sort of connected.
Yeah.
You also, but you said you have faith in the street, you also respected it when I think
well,
you said
I was
you,
told.
You.
I was told.
You had friends that were like in a kickboxing or boxing club.
A whole boxing club.
And they wanted to hurt this guy, but I think someone asked you not to, right?
The plan was they called me. Now, I had already gotten a phone call saying, we don't want you to retaliate. And I was like, are you kidding? You know, so then I find out who he's the front guy for, the Colombo Crime Family. So next thing he does, he hires bodyguards for the next 6 weeks, you know, to make sure they're with him. Cause,
yeah.
My friends who were, you know, professional boxers and just street badass kids, they were going to go into the club two nights later, spread themselves out, and where every security guard was, plus him, when they go by the watch, as soon as they hit, they were going to knock them all out.
Yeah.
Start beating them, you know?
Yeah.
And thank God, I had to beg them back. No, don't do this, please.
Yeah,
this
for
be
sure.
Bad news for me. So, you know,
because I don't care how tough you are. I mean, to hit someone with a bottle, I mean, you could sucker punch someone, but then to actually hit them with a bottle, that's just...
And I wasn't looking.
Yeah.
Okay, he made sure I wasn't looking when he hit me in the face. And he is a coward. Now, he introduced Ellie Boy Persico and his father, who was the head of the Colombo Crime Family, to undercover DEA agents. Now, they were moving about 25,000 hits a week of ecstasy out of the club. You're talking about lots of money, hundreds of thousands of dollars a week. And he ratted them out. He introduced them to two undercover agents, and Alley Boy and his father are in jail for life because of him. Now, there's supposed to be an open hit on him, you know? But, you know, so many years have passed, and he's back in South Beach, but I think he's working for the government.
Must be, yeah.
You know, that's why he hasn't, because, you know, an open hit is usually paid. And $100,000, you know, any wannabe new gangster trying to, you know, climb up the ladder,
yeah,
we're taking him out. So, no, he's working for the government for sure.
Now, before we talk about the other guy, Bostin Loyd, one of my favorite shows is called Mob Talk with Dave Schrattweiser and George Anastasia. And Mike Russell, who you work with, mm-hmm, has been on that show many times. So who is Mike Russell for the folks at home that don't know yet?
Mike Russell wrote a book called Mob Cop. You know, he infiltrated a Philadelphia crime family many years ago, and he's got actual 5 kills that, you know, the families of people he's killed have tried to sue him, but
yeah,
they can't, you know, and he actually says he has a lot more kills than that. I mean, no, he's just, he has my book, but I'm just...
Just kind of a wait and see kind of thing?
You know what, I decided he's not doing enough for me, so, you know, one of my fans has a connection to Dick Wolf out in California.
Oh, wow.
Well, you know, the Law and Order guys.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Plus, I mean, I have another friend, if you look him up, his name's Power David, probably the strongest guy I've ever seen. One of the strongest guys in the world. And he told me, he says, Mike, I mean, Mark Wahlberg knows all about it. You know, you're thinking, you know, we're from the same place, but
yeah,
why would he really know about me, you know? But Mark trained. And, you know, and read Muscle and Fitness, and I was in there constantly. And he said, yeah, he goes, Mark even said to us, he was doing bodyguard work on the set for Mark's movie. Mark said, you know, Mike Quinn's from Massachusetts. So I've got his, matter of fact, that's what I'm doing today, making copies of the books and sending it to them to people. And,
that's awesome.
I would like to see it as a documentary.
Yeah.
I don't think it's, I really didn't want a movie. I mean, who's going to play me? How are they going to make it real?
Right.
But I would like to just do a documentary because that would be good because I could tell the truth about drugs.
Absolutely. And talking about drugs.
Oh, God.
What's your story here with this? I mean, I don't even know if Bostin Loyd's the one that's doing it, but I told you Dave Palumbo wanted to have you on like 6 months ago. And, you know, I was talking to Dave and he's like, I'm going to have him on with Bostin Loyd. I'm like, why are you going to do that? And then things started, you know, clicking. And then I made that video a year ago, you know, supporting you and all that. So, we don't have proof it's Bostin Loyd, but it really looks like it's Bostin Loyd. What possible problem could this kid have with you? Why would he go up and say you don't know how to train people?
This is how it started. It started with one of my clients.
Okay.
All right. His name is Steve Lang. Well, he's a 4-time tour of Afghanistan.
Okay.
I mean, 6'3", monster, 280 pounds, real badass.
Yep.
Now, he had he was pretending to be somebody else on one of these sites or whatever they were talking about, and this whoever pretended to be, and my friend Steve figured it out because Steve was told, send me pictures of yourself, and Steve did, and then they came back because Mike Quinn's a shitty ass trainer, you'll never get anywhere with him. So he started this nightmare, and since then I don't pay attention to him, but now I'm hearing that what really set me off again was, I mean, I want people to not like this guy because he has no right to have any publicity. He couldn't hold my jock strap.
Right.
He's 22. I was Mr. Universe when I was 22. I won Teenage America before that. So he can't even win a state level show. So I don't know where he thinks he's, you know, he's getting all this bad, you know, thinks he's looking like some bad boy. He's not a bad boy.
Right. He won a regional show in California.
Yeah, he is a punk. I'm more than a punk. And, you know, and just recently, you know, I got to hear that, you know, he makes videos and attacks other pro bodybuilders.
Yeah, well, he's been attacking Jeff Long for I don't know how long. So,
first off, Jeff's a great guy. He's never talked bad to anybody that I've ever heard of.
No, he's a
class act. And why the fuck are you going after him? Hey, Bostin, have you got it together yet? You're not a pro.
Well, I think
you don't
what
have
he
a right
yeah.
to even say anything.
Yeah, I think secretly. I mean, I'm just speculating, but I think he may want Jeff to work with him, which I think is laughable. An IFBB pro working with a rank amateur MPC guy, but yeah, the other thing too is that he's had so many opportunities to say, hey, I never said anything about Mike or that wasn't me, and he hasn't. So
why would our sport want to promote somebody like that?
Right.
You promote a guy like me who's a bad boy, but you know what? I'm getting on stage and I'm walking the walk. I'm not talking too much, but I do what I say, and I showed up like a real champion. You know, I was a true champion. You know, it was nothing. I was an athlete. I wasn't a bodybuilder. It's a huge difference, you know.
And absolutely.
He you know, I don't want to even give him this much, but he's not even closely on my level, you know, and never mind on Jeff's level or anybody else. And you honestly think that judges don't hear about this kid and what he's doing, attacking people that are promoting the sport of bodybuilding, right?
Yeah.
All, me as a pro, I'm promoting the IFBB.
Right.
Right. No matter what, for the rest of my life, I promote the IFBB.
Yep.
And it's plain and simple. And so does Jeff and Phil Herndon and all my friends.
Right.
We all still promote the IFBB.
Yeah, to this day, Ron Love, you know, he's in his 60s, all about the IFBB, up, you know, up and down.
I mean,
so. As we wrap up the interview, though, tell us about your personal training business. I mean, you've prepped some guys. You prepped a guy just recently that took second, and you're prepping people that are looking phenomenal on stage. And you also preach minimal drugs, sometimes no drugs at all. So what?
Depends on the client. But I got a girl competing Saturday. Her name's Carrie Zoba.
Wait at the Bill Wilmore Classic this Saturday?
Wait, you see her. I mean, genetically, no drugs, so gifted, hard as nails. I mean, I've never dealt with an athlete with this superb of a metabolism. Never mind, it's a woman. It's usually a guy.
Yeah.
And she's, I'm trying, believe it or not, this is the first time I've ever had to get an athlete, try to keep her a little soft. Because she's that rock hard. You'll see her at the show. I mean, she's that rock hard. You know, has two kids, young kids, and she's a phenom. You know, I mean, she's just going to, I mean, legs, when she turns around, like, oh my God. I mean,
yeah.
Beautiful hamstrings, glutes tie in. Just, if you want to see what a perfect ass looks like, that's what a perfect ass looks like. Not to be
not
to be bad and say bad things, but that's a perfect glute to me.
And you train everyone. You train men's physique, bodybuilders, women's physique, women's figure, bikini,
yeah,
everything, right?
You know, I've only been building it for about a year. I got about. See, the thing with me is I talk to the phone with my clients.
Right.
You know, I get out of bed in the morning. That's the first thing I'm doing.
And you're at the shows with them, too, which is important. Right. Yeah.
I'm responsible for them.
Absolutely.
Know? They put their trust in me. And I'm also responsible for their health, you know?
And what we're going to do is below this video on YouTube and on Facebook, we're going to put put the address to your Facebook group, because you've actually had an imposter running around Facebook, too. So we want to make sure we get the actual account.
First, Facebook was hacked, lost 5,000 people. Well, I'm maxed again now. I have a Mike Quinn training page that I tell people to go there to get on. But, I'm using my email address for everybody to get in contact with me.
What's your email address?
ProMightyMikeQuinn@yahoo.com.
ProMightyMikeQuinn@yahoo.com.
Yeah. No, I listen, don't get me wrong. I really don't hate anybody or dislike anybody. I just don't, you know, I just dislike guys that lie.
Right.
And make themselves be bigger than they were. Like Gary Stridham saying he's drug-free. Get the fuck out of here.
Yeah.
You know how many people, like, laugh at that?
Yeah.
He thinks he's going to put a few sentences, I was drug-free.
Well, it's interesting, you know, because that show, I know Vince McMahon was terrified of the whole steroid witch hunt.
All
you guys were testing that Pasquale diet and all that, but...
Yeah.
He looked the same as 91, Gary Stridham.
He wasn't tested, you know, and if whatever he was doing for masking drugs, I'm in Florida by myself. These guys are all in California.
Yeah.
So these guys knew the masking things of that. And plus, you know, the guy's been on growth hormone, I think, since he's 4 years old, you know.
Mm-hmm.
He's just, you know, he gets shredded to the bone, but I'm sorry, you don't have a back. You're not even in the column of being a top bodybuilder.
Yeah, his back was... His chest was spot on, but his back was just not there.
His chest and shoulders were great, but you have that good chest and shoulders, and you turn around and have no back. It's over.
Yeah.
Well, look at through history. The best Mr. Olympians in the world, what they all have in common. Wicked V-tapers, frontal biceps, you know? I mean, even Arnold. I mean, look at him. I mean, I was way ahead of his game, you know? But
what do you think, by chance, what do you think of this big Rami guy? He's a monster.
All he keeps saying about him is...
Size.
Who cares?
Yeah.
I mean, okay, you're the biggest freak bodybuilder in the world. You know what? You don't have the credentials to go with it. And that should be very important. If he's going to... See, he's another freak that will just die out.
Right.
And nobody will talk about him in 5 years.
Maybe like
a... All through my history of me competing, there have been freaks all over the world. There are freaks as we talk right now in gyms that will never get on stage because, you know, they're just... They just won't, you know, because they don't want to lose. And the IFBB, you know, you are too much politics.
Yeah.
The politics are real.
Mm-hmm.
There's no doubt in my mind. But
who would you say is the best Mr. Olympia? Like, I know...
Lee Haney.
Lee Haney.
Hands down, he beat the king. You know, I don't care anybody after that. I don't care what Dorian or Ronnie did. Right. Lee's the king. Lee broke the record.
You know, I wanted to sort of wrap up, but, like, I'm going to keep asking you a few more questions if you don't mind. I'm just going to ask you, like, kind of questions I've been thinking about my whole life. Could Mike Christian ever have beaten Lee Haney?
Never.
Okay. Never?
First off, you got to beat this guy spiritually.
Mm-hmm.
I'm telling you, it's the first thing I told people. I could not beat him. His spirit is just so powerful. And if you think about God or anything like that, I mean, this guy gives off that kind of energy. And you got to be a sensitive guy to pick up on that. And I always told right at the beginning of my career, I can't beat him spiritually.
Okay.
Physically, I could beat him in the gym.
Okay, let me throw a spirit one at you. Could Rich Daspari ever?
Never.
Because he had the spirit, but he was just a little short side.
He didn't have the genetics.
Yeah.
Right? And, you know, Richie got a lot of gifts.
Yeah.
I mean, they created that whole controversy over the years of the Giant Slayer and all this.
Yeah.
Come on, he wasn't never close to Lee Haney. Never. Mm-hmm. You know, it's publicity, brother. They're creating stuff.
Sure.
You know, it's not the real deal. They're not telling the truth. You're going to tell me those three Olympians, there was nobody in there that could have beat him? Sorry. I don't care how shredded he got, and he was all veins. He had lousy muscle separation, if you really looked at his physique.
So let me throw another one at you here.
Yeah.
Between the two, at 100%, side by side, if you were the judge and you picked the winner, 91, Gary Stridham or Mike Christian, who would you have picked?
Oh, Mike, because his upper body. I mean, Mike wasn't heavily legged, but Mike's upper body was fucking awesome. I mean, he destroyed Gary in upper body. You know, it wasn't close. You know, now bodybuilding has come so much about legs, but back in my era, it was all about the upper bodies.
Okay.
You know, it's always been, you know, about upper bodies. I mean, the leg thing now is just, now they're just doing so much drugs, and every part of their body just grows. You know, I mean, I think the drugs are ruining the sport that I love.
Yeah.
It makes me sad, to be honest with you.
As far as Kai Greene goes, though, structurally, is there anything, if Kai Greene were to see this video, is there absolutely anything he can do to topple Phil Heath, or is it really his past? Or is
right. What everybody's going to seem to understand, they're only showing pictures of the night show.
Okay.
Okay, where he, you know, Phil peaked.
Yeah.
If you look at the pictures of the prejudging, he wasn't ready. Kai was spot on ready. You're supposed to win in the prejudging.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
That didn't happen. Okay. That pissed me off because I thought Kai should have won.
Because there's really nothing. On. I mean, he's the best poser. I mean, I'm a Phil Heath fan. I'm not gonna lie. I'm a Phil Heath fan. But
yeah, I think
but
he's awesome.
Kai Greene is the best poser. Yeah. Is the most muscular.
Listen,
has the smallest waist. No distended gut. Not that Phil Heath has a distended gut, but the thing about Phil Heath
he's
is that
he's trying to get bigger and it's ruining his physique.
Yeah, and I think the thing too is like you guys back in the 80s and the guys in the 90s, there really wasn't such thing as a relaxed pose. Even a relaxed pose, you were still holding it. Some of these guys now, when they say relax, they let the gut out. That's a big mistake. And I think maybe Phil.
What did I tell you about what the growth in insulin is doing to their organs?
Yeah.
I mean, their organs are growing.
When would you say that? Well, I think growth was in the mid-90s, but when would you say bodybuilders started using insulin? Like, when... it wasn't around in the 80s? Like, they didn't use it?
No. I never even heard about it.
Okay.
I mean, I didn't even hear about it in the beginning of the 90s. I mean, I never even heard if Dorian ever did it.
Yeah.
But, no, I'd have to say, God, when did we start hearing about insulin? Probably 95 on.
Okay.
About. I could be wrong, but, yeah, maybe 95.
And the synthol wasn't even heard of till recently, right? Nobody did that, right?
Get me going on that. That's just a fucking joke.
Yeah.
Let me tell you something. Any human being who does that to his body to win a show, you're a fake motherfucker.
Yeah.
Okay? I don't care who watches this. You're the fakest guy ever. Okay? So don't even waste your time.
I'm not even like looking you dead in the eyes. So you're scaring me. So I'm looking down.
Fuck, man. Come on. That's a disgrace.
Yeah. It was not muscle. It's just really is.
Why the sport's dying.
Yeah.
In 5 years, I think it's going
to
be over.
Well, I've heard a lot of people say that. A lot of people are looking to men's physique because there's a lot less drugs and,
okay.
You know, they're not as big. But I still love bodybuilding.
It's very simple. If you look at men's physique, my era, I mean, how hard and conditioned they're coming in, my era was just like this.
Yeah.
You know, but bigger. Mm-hmm. You know, but we have that same kind of conditioning. It's not acceptable by mainstream.
Yeah.
My era, we were accepted mainstream. It was like being a fucking rock star.
Right.
Everywhere I went, people recognized me. And I'm talking about people who didn't even train.
Yeah.
Because I was on so many covers. You know, people could look at me when I was younger and say, you know what, if I work hard, you know, I can look like him.
Right.
You know, and possibly they could if they had the kind of fucking balls I had in the gym, you know?
Yeah.
I think anybody of my height and, you know, trained hard and took drugs could, you know, very much look like me, but that never happened.
Yeah, a lot of guys back then, Bob Paris too, and even Rich Gaspari looked like a freak, but only because he was so dry. But I mean, he looked, you know, it was attainable, you know. And Samir had some killer triceps too.
The best picture I've ever seen on any bodybuilder ever is Samir doing a back double bicep when he won the Olympia in '83.
Mm-hmm.
I've never seen anything like that.
Yeah,
I mean, the way his lower lats separated totally from his spinal erectors. I mean, it looked like a clamshell.
Yeah.
You know, all the lines. I mean, it was, I don't think anybody's ever been better than that. And for me, I don't know why Samir never had gone back to that look.
Yeah.
Because, you know, people are having to be bigger now, and bodybuilding was getting bigger. But Samir, you know, like in 88, he got on stage at 205. Samir should have been 195. You know?
I think the fear there is like, or the fact there is that the Mr. Olympia sets the standard. So I think they were all trying to be a better Lee Haney than Lee Haney. And I think that's what they're scared of now with this Big Ramy guy. If Big Ramy ever became Mr. Olympia.
Big mistake.
Yeah.
You know, I never compared myself to anybody, ever. I had no fear in anybody.
Yeah.
A lot of respect for Lee. I mean, the biggest compliment I ever got, Lee had just won his third or fourth Olympia. We were in L.A. shooting for the magazines. And I asked Lee, I said, Lee, can I grab a workout with you? You know, I'd like to train with you. And he looks at me with a southern drawl and goes, Mike, I ain't training with you. You're crazy. And that was the biggest compliment I think I've ever gotten bodybuilding.
That's awesome.
Lee, yeah,
well, I think that's probably a good place to end the interview because I think that's classic. So I really, really want to thank you for talking to me over the years and doing this interview.
Thank you.
And I had a great time. Your parents are awesome. And we're going to put this video up today. Absolutely. So again, for Mighty Mike Quinn, this is Christian Duke, strengthaddicts.com.
Thank you.